Yes, so we will finalize the thread discussion by talking about synchronization issue, which is this critical section access and handling, coordinating threads. So I think last week we were at this point. So here is your multi-threaded process, and basically every process is by default single-threaded, the main thread, but sometimes we may need additional threads. So in this case, I have two additional threads in, and plus the main. So I have three threads around in this example. But the point here is...
Hocam, can you...
Hocam, you're not sharing.
Okay, yes, thank you for the update. Share the screen. And... Yes, okay, I think it is shared. So the threads, this is a multi-threaded process. The main thread is always there. It exists at all times. And here I have two additional threads, thread one, thread two. So here in general, in total, I have three threads around. So the first thread is running, is starting its thread of execution from this function, which is a function that just adds something to the shared global variable. And the second thread starts its execution from another function. It is the same function in this case. And so the join is like the wait function. So when the thread one exits, like it finishes its function, so it reaches here, or you can call pthread exit explicitly, then the main thread escapes, unblocks from this call. So it continues, and when thread two also finishes, it also unblocks here. So main thread reaches here, and then it prints something. So here is the synchronization problem. Although I increase the count, the shared count variable from zero, and I increase it 10 million, is it? What is this? It is 100 million, yes, 100 million. And two threads are adding 100 million additions to the initial count. So I expect 200 million in the end, but I never reach to that point because of the following reasons. So this is the shared variable, but although you see only one statement here, but in the CPU there are many cycles that you need to complete this statement. So you should see this, expand this like this maybe. Okay, so in the assembly level, the CPU instructions are like this, not like this. So basically you have some stuff. So in this case, I have like 10 different cycles to complete one addition. And the problem here is when you, actually I have a better visualization for this, in this slide, for instance, here this thread reads this value, it puts it to the register and increases the register and then writes it back to the memory location for that variable. And it becomes one, then it becomes two. Okay, so one, two, I increase twice. After zero, I get two, which is the correct result. However, what happens in that problem, in that example, is something similar to this. I read zero, and then the context switch occurs, and the thread, the second thread, it also reads zero to its own register. This reads zero to its own register. So, because when the context switch occurs, all the registers are updated. So, this thread one increases zero to one, and then this increases that zero to one. So, I have ones in my hand now, and then the thread one writes the one to the output, the shared variable as one. And then when the context switch comes to thread 2, it will write 1 again. Because remember, at this point, it has the information of 1, not 2. So here, instead of 2, I get 1. So I get something less than the desired output. So in general, this is what is happening here, actually. I have... so you will never exceed this number, but you will always remain below this number. Yeah, so that is the point. And now I will synchronize these two threads so that this access will not hurt the other in a bad way. And by the way, I purposely select a big value here, like 100 million, because that way I guarantee some kind of context switch. If I just use it like 100 here, then the time to finish this part is so quick that the context switch will not even hurt. Yeah, so that's why this problem will arise with the big numbers. But there is this possibility. So it is very annoying. We should fix it. And we will fix it like this. So here I am just talking about this issue. This is a problem. And we will handle this, which is like the most important topic in this course, arguably, synchronization. So again, I need to synchronize the threads and coordinate their activities so that when you access the shared data, I don't have any trouble. By shared data, I mean a global variable, for instance, or a file.
Hocam, sorry, can you explain that bit again? Like, because, you know, when it looks like it, you know, threads, they append to the, you know, they increment the, you know, count, the shared count variable. But the thing is, they don't care about its value. They're simply adding it. So shouldn't it be still 200 million?
Yeah, I tried to explain it in the first slide, but I hope that I have okay, so here it is another way to look at the same issue. Okay, so I have this, so I was going to come here, but let's jump here quickly. So I have one thread that wants to increase shared variable count from 5 to 6. And then another thread will decrease it. Okay, so they will not both increase it, but still same idea. But you will see that in the end of this increase and decrease, I should have get 5, right? Because I increase to 6, then it will go to 5. But there will be a problem. So here you can observe the problem as follows. So when this thread is being executed, okay, so the register in the CPU gets the value of 5, which is the initial variable value. This is the shared global variable, 5. Then in the CPU, this register gets updated during the cycles, and it becomes 6, okay? So, but still the shared variable hasn't been updated. And now be careful. At this time, I was going to increase count to 6. But at this time, a context switch has happened. It may happen because this is arbitrary. The scheduler decides this. So from this point, another thread, which is this thread, comes to CPU with its own registers and everything. So into that register, I put the count value. I go to the memory. I read this value. It is still 5, unfortunately. I expected it to be 6, but there was some preemption. So this got out of the CPU too quickly. So what happens is this register 2 for thread 2 reads value of 5, unfortunately. Then it makes it 4. Yeah. And then what happens is, so another context switch occurred. So into this count, I will put 6 now. because I am now in this context, in this thread. Yeah, six. And this is done now, so I don't even need a context switch because the code has finished. So CPU is released and this guy goes to CPU now and it will put register 2 value to the count. So it will make the count 4. See? So here is the problem. Because in a normal world, I was expecting to get 5, right? Because there was this variable. It was initial value 5. I made it 6 and then I decrease it to 5. Or I first decrease it to 4, then I increase it to 5. So I will always expect 5. But it wasn't the case, as you can see. So is it clear now? Now I show you the steps.
Yes, Hocam, thank you. So basically, while the thread 1 is incrementing, you know, trying to increment, reaches the value of count, meanwhile, the second thread might have already incremented it, mm-hmm. and the third thread is not aware of it. So it's incrementing to the old value of it.
Yeah, exactly. So don't look at the problem at the C level or at Python level. Look at it at the assembly level, where every statement actually unfolds into 3 or 4 statements. Okay, so these are the real statements that are going to the CPU. So when you think it like this, it will be more clear. Okay, so now then let's go in order. I will visit that page anyway later. So here is the process or whatever. I have a thread. But by the way, threads are going to be synchronizing. Similarly, processes can have the same issue because two processes may have a shared memory, for instance, as we have seen in the inter-process communication. So synchronization issue is always there. So here is the part of the process that is accessing and changing the shared data. And we call this region the critical region or critical section, assuming X and Y are the shared data, like shared variables. This is going to do this thread 2, thread 1. So these are the critical regions of these threads, the ones in the box, the place with the boxes. So the solution is simple, actually. And we have already implemented something like this in the previous class when I do the dot product, if you recall. The trick is no two threads are in the critical section at the same time. So they should be mutually exclusive. So this can be achieved using blocks or at a high level, if you are using an API, that provides you some mutexes, which are in the background setting these blocks. Or semaphores, or monitors, or condition variables. So we will see all of them today. Here is the general framework. We have this critical section where some global variable gets updated and some non-critical section. What you need to do is to play with the entry and the exit parts. Okay, so this is the idea of this class today. And here, for instance, if you come back to our very initial example, in this case, the critical section is where the variable is updated. And here, it gets respected, okay? Because once this thread is inside, only it is going to be inside. Until this finishes, no one else disturbs it. So here is a respected scenario, and there is no problem. Output is 2. But this is the bad scenario where more than 2 threads are touching the same value and they are both active. Here is another example. Let's do something with arrays now. Instead of just one global shared variable, let's also talk about a shared array. So assume we have 5 items in the buffer, okay? And count keeps the number of items in the buffer. So here are the scenarios. Producer produced a new item, put it into the buffer, and about to do count plus plus. So like this, the count will be 6. And assume consumer retrieved the item, so it should be gone. So from here, it gets it. So after that, count should be 5. Another scenario is first consumer got it, count is 4, and then producer produced it, count is 5. So in either scenario, I need to end up with the value 5. Inside the critical region, this is the region where the shared variable count gets updated. And as I told you before, in the background, you have 3 or more assembly instructions around. So, and these are the ones you should focus on to understand what is going on. And we just discussed this, so I am skipping here actually. So with the bad, unlucky scheduling, I end up with a count of 4, which is not 5. Another example is like you are sharing a bank account with your roommate, and you want to withdraw money, okay? So you have this thread. So orange is Ali and blue is Osman, for instance. So Ali reads the balance, the thread of Ali reads the balance, and so it is like initially 1,000. I guess, yes, initially 1,000. So locally, the balance, so assume that they will both withdraw 100 liras. So the balance becomes 900. But be careful, before I put this balance back to the account, so I update the account, Osman comes and uses the old account that has not been updated yet. So it also makes it 900. And it puts 900 back here. And then when the turn comes to Ali, it will put again 900 back because it was aware of this 900 here. So this is something good for the house, the friends, because their bank will still have 900 liras. But for the bank, it totally sucks because you have just lost 100 liras. So synchronization is very critical.
Hocam,
yes.
Can you re-explain the previous? Yes, this example again. I didn't get it.
Huh.
First of all, how this? I mean, I didn't get the execution sequence as seen by the CPU. I mean, how the CPU sees in that way, and then what happens in there?
Hmm. Okay, so it is not different from the previous example, but actually it is the same. So let me just repeat it then. So the first process or thread reads the balance of 1,000 into its own local variable balance, and then it sets it to 900. Okay, so far so good, I guess. And in a normal world, this orange thread should update the shared account to 900 TL, but some switch occurred. So this new thread now reads the 1,000 tier. Okay, so this is the bad moment because the balance, as far as the purple thread goes, the balance is still 1,000 because no transactions has happened yet. So this balance becomes 900, and the blue thread now updates the balance as 900, okay, which is nice as far as the blue goes. But when the turn comes to the orange, it will put the same 900 to the same account. So this is kind of redundant because the account has already learned that currently it has 900 inside of it. And here so, we say 900.
Okay, I got it. So if the orange thread is synchronized, the correct balance will be, well, balance will be correct because I mean blue thread was not able to interrupt it, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So if the blue and purple threads were mutually exclusive, like if only one of them were executing the critical section at a time, then there wouldn't be any problem. So it means that the purple part, so the it would have been like this. So the orange does the critical region, and then the purple does it. So, but here in this scenario, they are interleaved, and it was the cause of the problem. So if I can somehow force other threads to wait, not enter, but just wait for the initial thread to go out, so respect it, then there won't be any problem. Okay, so this is one example of synchronization. We will see other cases later, but currently focus on this mutual exclusion tactic. So here visually in thread one, there is no one inside, so I just let this in. Now thread two wants to come, so scheduler wants to put this here, but thread one will disable it, so thread one will not allow it. Okay, so something like this will happen. So thread two must wait. When thread one is out, hopefully it will finish at some point, and only then thread two can come. And actually we have seen this idea, as I told you. Now today we will see it in more detail with the all backgrounds, but here is a real world application where we do this dot product. We don't worry about the dot product, we update some global variable, okay, shared global variable, but before doing that we lock so that only one thread is here, and that thread unlocks, only that thread can unlock this mutex variable. So let's now understand this mechanism better. So at most one thread is currently executing the critical section. If thread one is outside the critical section, then thread one cannot prevent thread two from entering the critical section. That's why we should be aware of that. And also we don't want any starvation. So if thread one is waiting for the critical section, it should eventually get it. It shouldn't starve to death. And this little code that we will write today, like in the entry and exit, so where are they? Like, okay, so the blue parts here, they will be, the overhead of them will be very low. So because they will be very simple and small code. So the overhead of overheading, entering and exiting critical section is small with respect to the work being done within it. So here is my first solution. Now we will see some solutions. Okay, so so if you have lost your focus or something, now please come back and listen here carefully. Here is a solution called Peterson solution that works for two threads only. Okay, it doesn't support three or four threads, so this is a primitive solution, but it will give some idea to you. So here the what is going on, we will do some programming at the application, so we will not get any kernel support. So just doing some programming to handle this mutual exclusion. So let's talk about this solution first. Assume that I have this global variable called lock, integer lock, okay, seal variable. I set it to one initially, and then thread that wants to enter looks if it is one or not. If it is one, then it enters, and so So this is the critical region. Luck is 1, so threat 1 enters here. And luck becomes 0 now, because it does luck 0, minus minus. Now the threat 2 comes, and it looks at luck. It is 0, so it doesn't enter here. And when threat 1 leaves, it increases. So this looks like okay, but there is a problem. Because the luck itself is a shared variable now. Okay, so be careful. Luck is a shared variable. There is also another shared variable here, maybe called A. So, okay, I have handled the synchronization of A, but what about luck? So, for instance, let's consider it like this. When here is my critical region, threat 1 wants to come in. So it was going to set luck equal to 0 using this thing. But if you remember, in the CPU level, assembly level, I have 3 instructions here at least. So assume that some context switch happens here. So the luck to the outer world is still 1. And thread 1 is here. So when thread 2 comes, it will see 1 here, not 0. So it will also enter. So this is a problem, not working, because luck itself is a shared variable. So let me show you the correct solution then. Here is the solution. I will use an integer variable and also 2 boolean variables. So 2 processes share 2 variables, okay? The term and the flag. So the variable turn indicates whose turn it is to enter the critical section. So if turn is I, then PI can enter. And flag means if a process is ready to enter the critical section, like I want to enter. So this is the mechanism. Here is process I. Within this code segment, here is the critical section. So I will do the blue parts, the entry section and the exit section. So I want to enter. I am process I, so flag I is true. This is a fact. Now I am being nice to the other process, like being a gentleman. I give my turn to the other process, J. Okay? So if I is 0, J is 1. So I give the turn to J. Now, if J wants to enter, okay, it is true, and the turn is already J, so the process I, it just blocks. Okay, so this is the busy waiting. It means I just don't enter here, I just spend time by just working on this idle, empty while loop. Okay, so there is a semicolon here. So although it is my time to execute in the CPU, instead of doing some work in critical region, I just do some idle work. I just do nothing actually, but as far as the CPU is concerned, it just executes this empty statement. Okay, so this is a very stupid idea actually. You are just doing nothing, but you are just preventing synchronization errors. So you are doing something, but as far as the progress goes, you are doing nothing. Okay, so then when this process leaves, it says that I don't want to enter anymore because I am done. So flag I is false. So here you will understand it better because I now expand it into 2 process version. So let's follow here. So process 0 wants to enter, so flag 0 is true, and it gives the turn to process J. So turn is 1 here. Assume that process 1 has not executed yet, okay? So flag K is 0 now, okay? Because process J, 1 doesn't want to enter, it is not even alive. So this statement is false. This is true, but as you know, the condition false and true, it is false. So I escape from the while loop. So process I is now in the critical section. And when it is done, it says that I don't want to be in the critical section, false. So this is the sequential case where the scheduler first asks the process 0 to execute and then process 1 will execute. Now let's consider the other scenario. So process 0 will execute here and then process 1 wants to come in and then process 0 will continue. So let's see if what is going to happen. So process 0 wants to enter true. It gives the turn to 1 and assume that J wants to enter. Okay, so this guy has already made it announced that I want to enter. So flag 1 is 1. And it it gives the turn to 0, but it will not affect it. So flag 1 wants to enter. So basically, when this process scheduler comes here, then this is true because of this part, and turn is already true because of this part. So process 0 gets stuck here. And so when the time comes, process 1 does its thing. It is in the critical section because this part is true and its flag is already true. So it does the critical section, and when it leaves, at this point this becomes false, so this affects here. So process 0 is also going to work. So is it clear, the Peterson idea? This is the first solution. It just supports two threads. It is not a very good solution, so you cannot run this when there are more than two threads in your process, but still it gives a good idea for two process solution. Another solution can be the following. So this is a software solution because I do some flag and turn based decision. The hardware solution is as follows. There is a kernel code, the operating system's code. It can disable the clock interrupts, okay? So because after all, if there is no interrupt, then there is no context switch, okay? So when the process 0 enters here, kernel just it disables the interrupts. So it basically, essentially disables the scheduling. So it does the critical section without any problems. And when it quits, it enables the interrupts back. So this is a hardware solution. This idea is okay if you have a single CPU, because everyone will definitely execute in that CPU. But if you have multiple CPUs, which is the current configuration these days, this idea doesn't apply, because you are going to disable the interrupt for only the current processor, only one processor. So assume that this is going to execute in CPU 0. Okay, you disable the interrupts for CPU 0, but then in CPU 3, for instance, another thread who is going to access this critical section can execute in CPU 3, CPU number 3. So it will then update this critical section. Then you may ask, why not I am disabling all the processor interrupts? Then it will just make it very inefficient, because this is not the only process in your lives. There are many CPUs, and just to handle one synchronization, I can't sacrifice all my processors. Yeah, so that's why this is not a very good solution. But there are still good solutions with the hardware support. So what are they? There are some atomic functions. Okay, so the hardware provides these functions to you that are not interruptible. So once that function begins, you are sure that no other thread will context switch. So now let's talk about these atomic hardware functions. first of them is called test and set. So here is this machine instruction for hardware synchronization. So what this does is, obviously this is a machine assembly code, but here I am just going to write the C code for you to make it easy to understand. But keep in mind that this is not a C code, okay? This is just for the understanding. So let's get the lock, which is the enter section of the code. So basically what this code does is, first of all, again, I emphasize that this is atomic, meaning that the CPU, so in the middle of it, for instance, at this point, another thread cannot execute this function, okay? So once thread zero starts it, it will certainly execute all these three instructions, okay? So assume that is going on. What this does is the following. Some boolean comes in, I will return the original value as RV, but I will also set the parameter here to true at all times using call by reference. So the color will be updated. So let's put this in action. It will be more clear in this slide. Initially, I have this boolean global shared variable called lock. Okay, it is initially false, so there is no lock. Everything, so no lock means that you can enter. So assume that thread zero comes here. So test and set, it will return false because lock is false initially, and test and set will return false here. However, the good news is by call by reference, lock becomes true now. Okay, so now I am here. And now thread one comes, and remember, lock is true now, okay, so because of thread zero. So this returns true then, this function, and it says true to true, which is redundant, idempotent, but still it is true. So what happened is, since while true, so this became like while true, like infinite loop, I do nothing. I do busy wait or spin lock like forever when the turn is T1. And also assume T3 comes or T2 comes now. It reads as lock true. So this returns true and it sets true to true. So lock is still true. So what happened in the current configuration is T1 in. Sorry, I told it T0, I guess. T0 in, T1 and T2 waiting on lock. So when the T0 goes out, okay, so T0 is over, it sets the lock to false. Okay, so T0 is out now. So the scheduler, totally arbitrary, it may give the permission to T1 or T2, I don't know. Let's say that T2 is the current process or thread. So what happens is lock is false now. So test and set will return false because this thing is false now. And it also sets lock to true using this statement. So T2 is in now. T2 in and T1 is still waiting on lock. Okay. So this is the solution that is made possible using this hardware function called test and set, written in assembly using complex machine instructions. And by the way, if you really want to look at the test and set code, it looks something like this, like compares the register, jumps, if not equal, etc. So there is some assembly code here. Basically, this is the atomic code that will not be interrupted. So, but again, this is detailed. So just assume that this function is happening. And by the way, writing that instructions in your C code is not that big a deal. You can just write using this __ASM and __. So you can now write your assembly code within your C code. Okay, so it shouldn't scare you. So this is one way to write it. Another, so after this, I will give a break, but this is very related. So let's also finish this. So what about swap? So instead of test and set, here I will use a different function, okay, called swap. What it does is very clear. A, B, I swap. So A becomes B, B becomes A in the end. And again, very important, this is atomic. So in the middle of it, like here, there, the contact switch will never occur. Okay, so once T0 is here, it will definitely finish here without any interruption. So how can you use swap now in your life? You can use it like this. You have a Boolean variable called luck. Again, actually the same. Initially, no luck, false, unlocked. So what I do is the following. I set the local key to true. If key is true, yes. So I swap key to false because luck is false. So luck becomes true now and key becomes false. I just swap it. And since key is false, I escape from the while loop, the busy waiting. And so T0 is now in. So let me write here T0 in. Now at some point, T1 comes, okay? Key is true, but luck is also true. So swapping them will do nothing. I just swap true with true. So since key is true, I will swap it forever. So this is again like busy waiting. Instead of doing nothing, I am doing again essentially nothing, but I am executing three statements in the swap function. But long story short, T1 waiting on luck. And then T2 comes. And then maybe T3 comes, and maybe even T4 comes. They are all waiting on luck. So when T0 goes out, so this is the exit section. It is not even a machine instruction. It is very simple. Just set it to false. But again, this is non-interruptible. That's why it is machine instruction. Anyway, when luck is false, so T0 is out now. So I 1, 2, 3, 4 is waiting. Let's pick randomly number 3. So when the term is T3, what happened is luck was false now and key was always true. It is local. Key became false and luck became true. Okay. So I escape from here and I also luck my luck by using luck equal to true in the swap. So this is another smart solution, and it guarantees that the others are outside of the critical section. Yes, so let's give a break, and we will continue with semaphores and other types of synchronization primitives in 10 minutes.
Hocam, and this works for threads because the threads share, they have this shared lock of arrival, which they can both change. It won't work with processors, right?
Yeah, for threads, it's true, but for processes, the idea still applies. Like you create a shared memory using shame-get function. In that memory, you can maintain that luck variable. But we show it over threads, but it will synchronize processes as well.
So the difference of processes will have to, you know, allocate a specific shared memory. It can just rely.
Yeah, exactly. It is more work, like talk with kernel, get a memory, and it is more work to do. That's why you can assume that the multi-threaded functions will be more common.
Thank you.
See you in 13:45. Okay, bye.